loud. It's nothing like it. Amen. Out quietly, you don't have to wake everybody up in the house. But just having the word of God coming out of your mouth. And what I like about that is the Bible says God creates the fruit of your lips. If you don't say nothing, nothing for God to create. Whosoever shall say to the mountain, be thou removed. And doubt in your heart. And don't doubt in your heart, but believe that those things that you say shall come to pass. You shall have whatever you what? Say. If you don't say nothing, you just don't what? Get nothing. Although you might be born again, all of these rights and privileges are yours, but this is called a confession. Amen. Your walk with the Lord is called a profession. And the Bible says, hold fast to your, amen, profession of faith without wavering. I'm just talking today because in y'all heart, amen, I put a whole lot of heavy stuff on you. Amen. Others probably just go on in there. Amen. I'd just be too much for you. But I just talk off the top of my head. Is that all right? Or your walk with the Lord is called a profession. That means that the things that God has provided through His redemptive work are binding. They are legally yours. They are legally yours. I mean, every blessing that God paid for, that Jesus went to the cross and died for and redeemed you those are actually rights and privileges and things that are legally yours. Amen. But many of these things which are legally ours will never become ours in reality, because our walk with the Lord is called a what? Profession or a confession. That means that you're not going to make the legal aspect of your redemption reality until you begin to what? Confess or claim what God has already what? Promised. You have to what? Claim it. You have to say it.
Yes.
Amen. How many remember that's how you got saved?
Yes.
Amen. How many were down on the altar? I remember when I was on the altar. I grew up in a holiness church, and every altar call I had to go to. And I just went up there and went to sleep.
Amen. Amen.
And, if you grew up in the church, boy, believe me, you're going to the altar, right? Because all our mamas want to say, they want to say, amen, as early as they could get us saved. And that was good. Amen. All of my sisters and brothers got saved except me. Well, my sister, that was much younger, of course, she was a baby. But everybody else, I was the hardest one. I just didn't want to get saved. I said, man, I just can't. Amen. If I got saved, I don't see how I could just stop lying. I don't see how I could live saved one day. I just didn't want to get saved. I say, it's just too hard to live saved. But they still made me go to the altar. I got down there, and I just, you know, I was there. Nothing ever happened. But I don't see how you can live in a holiness church, have church, go to church every time the church door open, and you never feel the power of God in 21 years. I've never felt nothing. I mean, in terms of actually, you know, surrendering or yielding. It wasn't, you know, you felt the anointing, but it was nothing like a real conviction or something that was really drawing me, something that was really convicting me and making me want to be saved. And it was the only time I got convicted is the day that I got saved. I was 21 years old, and I was at my brother's church. That was our church in Pinewood, Arkansas. And I had a good friend. We just had finished college. He was a art major, and he was very talented, and he was going with a young lady from Detroit. Anybody heard of Madamos Clark? Yes, they were kind of connected with that bunch. And this girl could really sing, and she was liking my friend, but he wasn't saved. And she told him that he had to get saved in order for her to what? Even consider getting married to him. So he was trying, amen, he was really trying to get saved. He was trying harder than I was. And I wasn't trying until this woman came to me that was there. It was two women that they put over the prayer meeting to pray for us to get us saved. It was two women, and both of them were really gifted. in the spirit. One lady, about half of the prayer meeting, and I'd just been there for I don't know how long, I didn't feel nothing. I was ready to go. And this lady broke out in the spirit. The Lord showed her something. This is what she said. Death. See, from a little boy, since I evaded, you know, getting saved, I ran from it. If the saints begin to prophesy, and you know how they used to prophesy, scare you up, and you would try to run out of the church, get out of there because you know what, nobody come point you out and say something will happen to you. And so I just got out. Whenever that spirit started moving, the gifts started working, I just got out. But this lady, I couldn't get out that day. She said, death. Because I had been dreaming about death because I guess the way of a transgressor's heart. And I had dreamed that I died and went to hell. I wasn't ready to meet God. So I dream that all the time. Amen. All the time. You know, when your mothers put them prayers on you. Amen. You might be able to get by, but you don't get away. Amen. My mother was a church mother, and she was the main prayer warrior at the church. The shirt ends and all that. We did all that. And, but when this sister said, death today, so I've been dreaming about that 5 years probably, maybe 10. And when she said, death today. She said, death today in this church. And I just said, well, this is it. I'm going to die today, and I'm going to die in this church. But if I die today in this church, I'm going to die saved. For the first time, I kicked away my prayer. Because I didn't want nobody, you know, think about you have to open your mouth. And people singing or testifying, everybody got their mouth open and howling loud, and praying loud, singing loud, and dancing and all that. So when she said death today, I just got so shook. I was just shaken. I was really shaken. So I just said, man, I better do something. I better do something right away. So I opened my mouth. I began to scream. And I began to say, Lord, help me. Save me. Well, I don't know what all I didn't say. And after screaming and crying and beating the floor and rolling for about 15 or 20 minutes, I started speaking in tongues. Man, if I hadn't had that heavy word thinking I was going to die and die today, I probably would have been saved today because my best buddy, he's a fireman, and he's a retired fireman. He's my first cousin. To this day, we ran together. To this day, he ain't saved. And he's about 70 years old. But if it hadn't been for that word that woman spoke, I misinterpreted, but it worked. I guess the Spirit would have it that way. And after I got saved and filled with the Holy Spirit, and I talked in tongues for about 2 hours. And then after a while, somewhere down after several minutes, this lady began to interpret what she had, what she was saying. And she said, death today in the church. She said, there's spiritual death in the church. Y'all know what that means, spiritual death? It means you got a whole lot of folk what? Ain't what they're supposed to be. That's spiritual death. Right? I said, man, I know that. I mean, I said, she was talking about spiritual death? And I was thinking that she was talking about what? Natural death. And so, well, it was all over. It was history then. Amen. Boy, I found the peace, the joy. The first thing that I did when I got up after those 2 or 3 hours,